The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Well, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Good morning and welcome to Oxford United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Caleb, and we are so glad that you've joined us for worship today. Yes, it is Super Bowl Sunday, but we are here about a different sort of business this morning, and that is to worship our Lord in spirit and in truth. Well, as we get into our service this morning, we do have a few announcements for you. Number one, make sure to fill out that yellow card that is in your bulletin, along with any tithes or offerings that you might have this morning. You can take those with you at the end of the service and put them in the baskets that are back near the entrance to the sanctuary. Also, today, after this service, we want you to stick around for a little while because down in the fellowship hall, our circle groups are busy getting things ready for our fellowship time immediately after service. So we invite you to come be a part of that for a little while. You don't have to stay for an hour, but I know when Methodists get talking, that's usually what happens. So just come down, enjoy some time with one another. Also, we do have Ash Wednesday service coming up. Lent is upon us. That'll be on Wednesday, February 22nd, and we will have service in here at 7 p.m. That's typically when we do the imposition of the ashes, but as I mentioned last week, if you would like to come during office hours and receive those then, I will be here to do so. Also, because it is Super Bowl Sunday, there will be no youth group this evening, and next Sunday, February 19th, the college students' meal theme is a chili cook-off, and we are asking you to provide some chili for that cook-off because our college students are actually going to judge each of those. And so we would love to have you do that. If you are interested in doing that, please contact Alexia Wing, our college director. Well, that is all of the announcements I have for you this morning. Would you please rise in body or in spirit as Brody comes forward to lead us in our call to worship?
You can find our call to worship in our bulletins. I'll get us started, and please join me in the bolded section. Called by God, we have come to worship. Called by Christ, we have come to follow. Called by the Spirit, we have come to rejoice. Called together, we will listen and pray.
As we continue our worship this morning, we're going to sing a song now called Blessed Be Your Name. And we are singing to the Lord this morning. Blessed be His name, blessed be your name. And you'll see in this song, we will sing many different ways that we bless the Lord's name in many different circumstances. Couple of those, when the land is plentiful, or when I'm found in the desert place. We've probably all been in those situations, haven't we? When the sun is shining down on me, and when in the world as it should be, we bless the name of the Lord all the time. But what about when the road is marked with suffering? And as the psalm says, there's pain in the offering. We still bless His name. So whatever situation you find yourself in this morning, let's praise the Lord. Let's give Him thanks for the many blessings that we have. Please join us.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, sing it out now, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. Let's lift a round of praise. Amen.
As we come to our time of prayer, we will start with our individual prayers, and as we do that, we have candles on both sides where everyone is welcome to come up and light a candle. Maybe there's something on your heart or mind, or someone on your heart or mind this morning. Maybe it's you want to light a candle of praise or petition. Everyone is welcome to come up, and we've got plenty of time to do so. After our individual prayers, I'll close us together. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time that we can gather together as one body to worship you, to praise you, and to hear your word. We thank you for this day and for this church and for the people around us that we call our church family. Lord, you have heard our many individual prayers, and you know us. You know where our hearts and minds and thoughts are today, right now. Please hear our prayers, Lord, and grant us peace and comfort. And Lord, we also have people in our lives that are in need, that are hurting, that are dealing with uncertainty, and are likely dealing with something we know nothing about. We pray for these people, for their happiness and for their strength. As we watch world conflict play out in front of our eyes, Lord, we ask for guidance as a people watching. Our world leaders are continuing to sift through the war in Ukraine. Please give those leaders clarity, confidence, compassion, and care as they maneuver very difficult decisions. For those battling in the war, please protect them and guide them where they can be safe. Lord, our hearts are breaking for the tragedy in Turkey and Syria with the recent earthquake. Please give strength to those assisting in the relief efforts. Please give clarity to those providing medical treatment. Please comfort those that have lost or are still searching for their friends and family. And please provide clear paths for the resources needed to bring relief. And for those away from the situation, please present us with the proper ways to give and donate or volunteer in helping our brothers and sisters across the world. Seeing this war and seeing the earthquake devastation puts a lot of our worries and discomforts into perspective. Lord, you have blessed us, and we thank you for the small things in our lives and the big. Please continue to bless us in this day and bless us throughout this service and our week ahead. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we get to our scripture reading for this morning, I will introduce our guest speaker in a moment, but I also want to give some instructions on the scripture reading for today, because you have a part in the scripture reading. So basically, Emily, after I introduce her, is going to come up here, and she's going to read the first part of the verse, and then you are going to finish it. Now, Brody's going to help lead you, number one. And it's the same thing over and over again. So after you get it the first time, you should get it for the rest of the time. So I expect your voices to gradually get louder as we go along. Well, it is my honor this morning to introduce our guest preacher. Emily Beth Hill is a theologian interested in economics, surveillance, social justice, and how cultural systems affect our worship and practice in the church. She holds a PhD in theological ethics from the University of Aberdeen, an MA in social justice from Kings College, an MA in economics, and BS in business economics from Miami University. Before pursuing theology and ministry, she spent 10 years working in international marketing research. Emily is the author of Marketing and Christian Proclamation in Theological Perspective, which I definitely recommend. She writes and speaks about issues of economics and marketing in the church and currently serves in the Theological Formation Department at InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. Emily is also a co-host of the Theology and Podcast podcast. Well, and the way that I know Emily also is that we helped lead up the Cincinnati Theological Society. That's where I first met her, and I have been impressed with her, just her spiritual and intellectual acumen and the way that she comes to the gospel. And so it is my honor to introduce her to you this morning. So would you welcome her? Give her a warm welcome this morning.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who alone does mighty miracles.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who made the heavens so skillfully.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who placed the earth among the waters.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who made the heavenly lights.
His faithful love endures forever.
The sun to rule the day.
His faithful love endures forever.
And the moon and stars to rule the night.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who killed the firstborn of Egypt.
His faithful love endures forever.
He brought Israel out of Egypt.
His faithful love endures forever.
He acted with a strong hand and powerful arm.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who parted the Red Sea.
His faithful love endures forever.
He led Israel safely through.
His faithful love endures forever.
But he hurled Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who led his people through the wilderness.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to him who struck down mighty kings.
His faithful love endures forever.
He killed powerful kings.
His faithful love endures forever.
Sihon, king of the Amorites.
His faithful love endures forever.
And Og, king of Bashan.
His faithful love endures forever.
God gave the land of these kings as an inheritance.
His faithful love endures forever.
A special possession to his servant Israel.
His faithful love endures forever.
He remembered us in our weakness.
His faithful love endures forever.
He saved us from our enemies.
His faithful love endures forever.
He gives food to every living thing.
His faithful love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of heaven.
His faithful love endures forever.
Well, thank you for reading that with me. I'm going to get to that psalm and reflecting on that in a little bit. Just thank you for letting me be here with you today to share a little bit about my work with InterVarsity and hopefully encourage us through this psalm to see how God is at work in the world and in our lives. I'm excited to be here for several reasons, including the fact, as Pastor Henry mentioned, that I went to Miami. So I'm really excited to walk around campus and maybe get some bagel and deli after this. I imagine that you all living in a university town, perhaps working or going to the university, are at least familiar with campus ministries. There are a lot of them, a huge variety of them, including this congregation, of course, which ministers on the university campus. And so InterVarsity is one organization that works specifically with students, faculty, and staff in their context and the unique joys and challenges of university life. That could mean a lot of different things. At InterVarsity, we focus on forming groups of students and faculty around the study of Scripture and then work out what does that mean for our life and whatever we're going through. For us, that includes helping students respond to God's love, to live justly, and to think about how God might be calling them to live out their faith in all of the areas of life, including their studies and their careers, and hopefully to then form supportive Christ-centered communities that can help support each other through life's ups and downs. One way that I like to summarize this is to say that we want to help students, staff, and faculty see that God cares about their work, and invite them into a variety of life-giving ways to think about that, but also to help all of us see that we are more than our work, that God loves us, that God provides for us and sustains us, and is inviting us into God's story in the world. I've been with InterVarsity for about 3 years now, and I started out working with graduate students at the University of Cincinnati. And for the last year, a little over a year, Pastor Henry said, I'm working in the Theological Formation Department. And so this is a staff-facing role, which means that we help equip the staff that work with the students and faculty to help them think and learn about theology so that they're more equipped for their own spiritual lives and their work with students. So I know you all know the value and importance of good theology with having Pastor Henry here. He's read way more theology books than I have. But what is it that we do at InterVarsity when we think about theological formation? Our staff all come from a wide variety of traditions and denominational backgrounds. So our goal is not to teach, you know, one way of thinking about theology. We really want to help people understand their own backgrounds and that they come from a particular tradition and those of others around them, whether the other staff that we work with or the students that they encounter. So we want to help them to be able to navigate their own questions of faith together, as well as working with students and all the questions that they face in these rather tumultuous times. To me and to those of us who teach theology at InterVarsity, this is not just an academic exercise where we're trying to work out formulas or one way to understand God. Instead, it's to join in the conversation about God, and with people in history, all around the world and from a broad array of experiences. This, I think, can enrich our understanding of God and our imagination about God to see how he is at work in the world. So I mentioned it's theological formation, and formation means that we don't think theology, again, is just a head exercise, although there certainly are things that we can try to understand. But we want to teach and learn theology in a way that teaches us and forms us into certain kinds of people so that we make space for people to reflect on how God is inviting them to respond to what they're learning and what they're experiencing. And so we hope that all of our programs help people grow in their relationship with God. So we teach three dimensions of theology at InterVarsity, and I have some flyers in the back if you're interested in just learning more about what we do. We believe first that theology should deepen, that's the first dimension, our intimacy with God. Again, we don't just want to gain information, but we want God to be revealed, and we believe that God is revealed in that way. And we think that in studying theology, this deepens our commitment to God, God's word, God's people, and God's purposes. And this grounds our own spiritual lives and why we do the ministry that we do. The second dimension is diversify. And so we want theology to cultivate tradition awareness. As I mentioned, we want people to understand that they come from a tradition, that there are multiple traditions, so that they experience the goodness of God in a variety of contexts, and that they learn to talk to each other across differences, and that expands our imagination of who God is. And the third dimension is discern. So we all, you know, make decisions in our life, and actually we're probably all using theology in some way when we do that, but we aren't necessarily naming that or recognizing it. So part of what we want to do is to help people be aware of the theology that they maybe already hold, what they might want to explore further, or what they might want to change about what they think about God and how they live. And so when it comes to discernment, we want staff to be able to see how to hold and prioritize theology along with their experience, community, and practical wisdom for the decision. So again, I mentioned I have some flyers. If you want to hear more about that, there's ways that we're teaching the three dimensions through courses and gatherings and the podcast that Pastor Henry mentioned. And this podcast, anyone can listen to. And basically, we're trying to address some of life's big questions through the lens of theology and other academic research. So we believe that these things make a real difference in the real world, and so we try to talk about that in ways that everybody can understand. I do also have a sign-up sheet if you're interested in getting email updates with prayer requests, and I also try to just incorporate little theological reflections that I hope are fruitful. And I will also note I raise my own financial support, so if that's something you're interested in, I'd be happy to talk to you about that. But now I want to turn to Psalm 136. And I hope in reflecting on that, we can practice one of the three dimensions I mentioned, which is deepen. This is a psalm, and there's a characteristic of God in here that has certainly deepened my own relationship with God. And I think it demonstrates one way that exploring who God is can make a difference in the way we live in the world. I don't know how you felt when you were just repeating that one refrain over and over. I found as I've tried to read the psalm myself, it's actually a little bit difficult to like stick with it, and it maybe gets a little bit tedious or annoying to repeat that phrase. But as we take turns reading it, I think that's helpful, and also how it would have likely been read in the temple. And as we alternated, we were essentially reading the two main parts of the psalm. The first is a line that speaks of an action of God in history or on behalf of God's people. And then the second is the phrase, the refrain that you repeated, his faithful love endures forever. And as I've reflected on this combination, including this repetition, I get the sense that we live in the continuous reality of God's faithful action, God's loyalty, love, and provision on our behalf, even and especially when we don't deserve it. So I want to just spend a few minutes elaborating on that idea. We read the New Living Translation because I like how it uses the phrase faithful love, which is a concept and a characteristic that's distinct from love as we might tend to think of it. And it's the Hebrew word chesed, which, I always forget the correct chesed, I think it is, which is a hard word to translate as well as to pronounce. But you'll often see it in various translations as steadfast love, loving kindness, or covenant love. It occurs 245 times in Scripture, and 127 of those in the Psalms. And I didn't count how many are in this psalm, but obviously there's a lot of them. It's one of the most defining characteristics of God that we find in Scripture. One Jewish scholar defines it as a free-flowing love that knows no bounds. As I reflect on this word in my life, as I've experienced it, I think it means to me that God is relentlessly for us, not because God has to be or is required to be, but because God wants to be. He is moved to be. He delights in it, and he has the power and the faithfulness to back that up. This faithful love is most closely related to God's covenant relationship with the people of Israel, as we heard depicted in the psalm. When God creates a people for himself who he calls out and provides for and protects even when they are unfaithful. We see this phrase come up a lot as God defines himself specifically in Exodus 34, 6, and 7. This is a core part of how God describes himself when he's talking to Moses. He says, Yahweh is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in chesed and truth, maintaining chesed to 1,000 generations, forgiving wrongdoing, rebellion, and sin. But he will not leave the guilty unpunished, bringing the consequences of the father's wrongdoing on the children and grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. Now, I have to read the whole definition that God gives of himself, although I hesitate to do this when I don't really have time to elaborate on that second half of guilt and punishment, and I know that there's a lot of ways in which that could be interpreted. But for now, I think we can say that God's full self-revelation is balancing his perfect love and his perfect justice, which will ultimately be revealed in Christ. But in this definition God gives, he speaks twice of his unfailing love. It says God is rich in faithful love, and God maintains it like someone guarding a vineyard. And this phrase, slow to anger, rich in love, or faithful love, is probably a phrase that you recognize because it becomes a shortened definition of God that we see repeated through Scripture. And another recurring phrase in which we hear chesed is the one from our psalm today. For he is good, his chesed endures forever. This doesn't just show up in the psalms, it's woven throughout Israel's temple worship and battles. It's a major recurring theme in their life and worship. And this use of the word, I think, reminds us that God's unfailing, steadfast love is eternal. It is everlasting, and it is indestructible. It is not momentary or fleeting. It is totally reliable, no matter what happens in the world and no matter what we do as God's people. And that's really powerfully portrayed in this psalm, not just with the phrase itself, but with that repetition and with the list of God's actions in the world. These actions are the ones that demonstrate God's faithful, everlasting love for his people. This is how we know what God's love is like. It's not just an emotion, but an action. So if we look at the actions of God in the psalm, we can see that it first talks about God's acts of creation. God created a good world. And then God created a people by rescuing them from Egypt. And he provided for them and guided them. He was faithful to his promises in delivering them and bringing to the promised land. What might this mean for us today? I believe as we recite these words and we remember the acts of God in the past, we bring them into the present. The God who created is creating. The God who sustains is still sustaining. And we can also add to these actions of God in history with our own ways that we've experienced God in our lives and communities. These words build our world. They tell us what life in the world is really like. Consider all the words and images and messages that are trying to tell you what is true. They tell you what the world is like, who to trust, who you are, or what you need. The news, social media, political parties, and marketing companies, just to name a few. People are spending billions of dollars to tell you who you are or what is real in the world. And of course, there can be good in messages that we find outside of Scripture. But there are also voices that are in conflict, telling us they can help us get what we need and that they are the source of all good. And as I reflect, so many of these messages we hear is telling us that there's not enough, that we're not enough, that we need to get more, that we need to be better. But this psalm and the rest of Scripture reminds us that we are grafted into God's people who experience God's faithful love in action. And we continue to experience that in the present. God is faithful, and we are God's people who he loves and cares for in concrete ways. This is the story and the reality that we are invited into. And I hope that in some way you have experienced this faithful action and love of God in your own life. I think a really dramatic point for me, and I think for us today, occurs at the end of the psalm when it says, God gives food to every living thing. With this being included in this psalm shows us that the provision of daily food is on the same level of God's action in creation and the Exodus and the deliverance to the promised land. I think that's a pretty profound truth if we let that sink in. Despite what everything seems to be telling us, God provides powerfully for our needs, and it's not all up to us. I think the Apostle Paul was rooted in this reality of God's faithful love when he was writing his letter to the Romans. He exclaims in a very famous verse in Romans 8, "What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else?" The same God who acted in creation and the Exodus, who provided manna in the wilderness and sent Jesus to bring us into the kingdom, is the same God still acting for us now. How will he not give us everything we need? Now, sometimes it's easy to believe this, that we live in the continuous reality of God's faithful love and provision. I don't always feel like that, though, and I imagine it is hard for you sometimes as well. God's not always doing dramatic things like parting the Red Sea, and a lot of times life just doesn't go the way we hope. We experience loss and suffering and distance from God. I really struggle with the fact that there are psalms like this one where we're told of God's love and God's rescue, and we praise him for being near. And at the same time, there are these psalms of lament where God's people cry out, "How long, O Lord? Where are you?" How can both of these things be true? And while I feel like that's a sort of intellectual struggle for me to hold on to, the presence of these various psalms is also a comfort. It's an affirmation that those are both real human experiences, and we aren't alone when we struggle to find God. But I hope as we pray the psalms like this one, as amongst all of the psalms, and as we gather each week to remind ourselves of this truth of God's faithful love, even if we don't feel it, that it helps us along in those other times. And if you don't feel it now, I hope that this community is able to hear and support you and also to hold faith for you. I think there are also ways that we can grow in practicing our awareness of this truth. We might practice naming the good things in our life each day or each week, whether small or big, in order to recognize that these are not just things that we have experienced or things that we have done, but things that show that God is at work in our lives, that we can receive them as fruits of God's faithful love. If you're open to it, perhaps write your own version of Psalm 136 with the ways that you have seen God's action in your life or in the world or your community. We don't just experience this as individuals, but as people part of a community. And if you're feeling pain or loss, as many of us likely are, perhaps read a psalm of lament or write your own. They make space to say to God, "We know you are a God of unfailing love, of faithful love and mercy, that you act on behalf of your people. Please act now." However you're feeling, ask God to show up and meet you. God's faithful love endures forever, and God is faithful to respond to the cries of his people. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your faithful love, for the ways that each of us in this community have experienced it. And we pray for those who do not feel that right now. We know that you are near. We know that you are faithful. And we pray for your provision in each of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now would you rise in body or in spirit as we sing our final hymn, "How Great Thou Art." We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. Thank you. Again, friends, I would remind you that at the conclusion of today's service, we have fellowship time down in the fellowship hall. After the service is over, please make your way down there. I know a few of you, you'd love to like fellowship for hours up here in the sanctuary, but we do invite you to go down there and enjoy the fellowship of our congregation together. And also, at the conclusion of the service, Emily and I will be standing there where I'm usually standing at the conclusion of the service. If you have any questions for her or want to hear more about her ministry, she has a clipboard where you can also sign up to receive her newsletters as well. Well, friends, hear the good news that you are a part of God's great story of his mighty acts, which began from the beginning of creation and led all the way to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the same God that created all things and the same God that redeems all things in Jesus Christ is the one that provides us exactly with what we need each and every day. Go with his love, which endures forever in your hearts this day. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us sing. Thank you.